From satellites malfunctioning to strange flashing lights seen by astronauts on the International Space Station, there's something odd happening in certain parts of space close to Earth, and the cause of these effects could have wide-ranging impacts on all of us in the future. Curious Droid. In February 2016, the state-of-the-art Japanese X-ray observatory Hitomi launched atop a Mitsubishi rocket into a circular orbit 570 kilometers above Earth. Its mission was to study high-energy processes like black holes and supernovae within clusters of distant galaxies. But after just a month of successful operations, the Japanese space agency, JAXA, announced that on the 26th of March, they had suddenly lost communications with Hitomi. Worse, the satellite was in an uncontrollable spin. Attempts by the internal guidance system to correct the rotation only made the problem worse, turning it faster and faster until the solar panels broke away, leaving Hitomi without power. On the 28th of April 2016, after a month of attempts to try and re-establish communications, JAXA declared the $273 million space observatory lost. But what was the cause of Hitomi's demise? The answer lies in the peculiar pattern of radiation which surrounds the Earth, discovered in 1958 by the first US satellite. The American physicist James Van Allen proposed fitting Explorer 1 with a Geiger counter attached to a small tape recorder to measure radiation levels above the atmosphere. Sure enough, Explorer 1 observed distinct patterns of radiation during its 111-day mission. These became known as the Van Allen belts. Donut-shaped fields of energized particles emitted from the sun and trapped by the Earth's magnetic field. In fact, the radiation belts were discovered by Sputnik 2 just over 2 months before the American Explorer 1. However, due to Sputnik's trajectory over foreign territory and the secrecy around the mission, it meant that when the signals were picked up by the Australians, the two sides refused to talk to each other, and the Australians refused to pass the data on. When the Soviets finally got their hands on the data, they mistakenly thought that the spikes in the radiation were a result of a recent solar flare, and by the time they figured out the real reason, the American Van Allen team had already announced the discovery. There are two main concentrations of radiation surrounding the Earth. An inner radiation belt made up of mostly energized protons that peaks at around 2,900 kilometers, and an outer radiation belt mostly consisting of electrons at peaks at around an altitude of 16,000 kilometers. The Van Allen belts are responsible for auroras such as the northern and southern lights, where they meet the Earth's atmosphere around the magnetic poles and channel charged particles into the upper atmosphere. It's here that they react with the atmospheric gases and form the colorful displays. The most common auroral color, a pale yellowish green, is produced by oxygen molecules located about 100 kilometers above the Earth. Rare all-red auroras are produced by high-altitude oxygen at heights of up to 330 kilometers, and nitrogen produces blue or purplish-red auroras. But orbital surveys revealed another large area where strong radiation dips down to just 200 kilometers above the Earth's surface, over a continent-sized area above the Atlantic coast of South America. This is known as the South Atlantic Anomaly, or the Cosmic Bermuda Triangle. And it's this that is the cause of the strange effects on both the human body and robotic spacecraft. In the 1960s and 70s, spacecraft in orbit relied upon early computer chips, which had much larger transistor sizes and were less sensitive to the bombardment of charged particles. This electronic toughness was especially important for the Apollo missions, which had to cross the Van Allen belt and leave the protection of Earth's magnetic field. But during the missions, the astronauts reported seeing spots and streaks of light, which continued to flash even when they closed their eyes. These visual effects are called phosphenes, and a 2006 survey of astronauts found that 47 out of 59 respondents had experienced them, some even reporting that the lights had disturbed their sleep. Although humans haven't crossed the Van Allen belt since December 1972, all spacecraft that pass through the South Atlantic Anomaly experience an increased dose of radiation, of up to 1,000 times the usual levels for low Earth orbits. To deal with this, the International Space Station is fitted with shielding that protects astronauts from some of the increased radiation when passing through the anomaly. Even so, the crew on the ISS each wear personal dosimeters, and electronic devices often suffer lockups or failures known as single event upsets. These are more common with consumer-grade electronics like laptops which are brought with the crew, which are built to less demanding specifications than space or military-grade components which are radiation-hardened. Since the space shuttle missions, astronauts have reported laptop failures over the South Atlantic. Fortunately, the fix is usually a simple reboot. One way to shield against high-energy charged particles is to use water. Good old-fashioned water makes an excellent shield against ions, electrons, and protons due to its high hydrogen content. Some astronauts have even taken to lining their sleeping areas with water bags and even their dosimeters to reduce their total exposure number to get longer and more frequent missions, but of course at their own risk of greater radiation exposure. However, the space telescopes like Hubble depend upon highly sensitive electronics to capture light from distant galaxies. As Hubble passes through the South Atlantic anomaly, operators routinely switch off imaging sensors to avoid damaging them. However, one of Hubble's cameras, the Wide Field Camera 3, can still function in this portion of the orbit, but the images still register the characteristic speckling of the radiation artifacts. Hitomi's light-gathering sensors were ultimately found to be the cause of the failure cascade that led to the loss of a Japanese satellite. When passing through the South Atlantic anomaly, the star tracker, which is used to orientate the craft with a known fixed point, suffered a series of glitches, causing the satellite to switch to backup gyroscopic instrumentation, which also then failed. Being on the opposite side to Earth from Japan and out of direct communication with mission control, the error was only discovered after it was too late. To avoid similar losses in future, space agencies are pursuing two strategies. First, to better understand the South Atlantic anomaly itself, and to make satellite electronics more resilient to the effects of radiation as they pass through the danger zone. But the South Atlantic anomaly is not a stationary phenomena. Since 1958, scientists have observed that the anomaly has been increasing in size and is also gradually moving northward and westward. This is in line with both the North and the South Poles, which are constantly moving around. Over the last 150 years, the North Pole has moved over 1,000 kilometers and has recently accelerated to 40 kilometers a year, and the magnetic South Pole is now over 1,000 kilometers away from the geographic South Pole. But there isn't just one anomaly either. In fact, there are many smaller ones scattered around the globe. The European Space Agency is currently mapping these changes with the Swarm mission, which launched three small satellites into polar orbits. Two of the Swarm satellites orbit side by side at an altitude of 450 kilometers, and one orbits at a higher altitude of 530 kilometers. Swarm has tracked fluctuations in the Earth's magnetic field since 2014, and the data has revealed strange weather systems deep beneath our feet that could be to blame for the spreading footprint of the South Atlantic anomaly. Beneath 2,900 kilometers of crust and mantle, our planet's core is in two parts. A central core of solid iron-nickel alloy about the size of a moon and at 4,500 degrees centigrade. That's as hot as the surface of an orange star like Arcturus, and yet solid due to the immense pressure of 50 million pounds per square inch bearing down on it. The second outer core is molten and about the size of Mars and fully envelops the inner core. As the planet spins, it's the movement of this molten metal outer core which is responsible for the generation of a magnetic field. As the outer core is molten iron and is a liquid, it is affected by the Coriolis forces that come from the spinning Earth. These forces create chaotic movement in the outer core, much like the weather in our atmosphere. And also, like our weather, this outer core weather is driven by heat, but instead of heat from the sun, it's heat from the inner core. This sets up massive convection currents combined with the swirling effects of the Coriolis forces, it creates weather systems and storms within the molten outer core. These storms create new temporary magnetic poles that can be opposite to the surrounding area. This is what the South Atlantic anomaly is. It's a pole reversal, and as such, it negates the effect of the magnetic field around it, weakening it and allowing charged particles to come much closer to Earth. Like atmospheric storms, these outer core storms can also merge and become larger, which is how the South Atlantic anomaly is believed to have grown in strength. The Swarm mission also has identified a molten iron jet stream within the outer core, flowing westwards beneath Alaska and Siberia at a speed of around 50 kilometers per year. Although this may not sound a lot, this dense flow of iron takes a huge amount of energy to move and is estimated to be hundreds of millions of years old. This increasingly chaotic behavior in the outer core is thought to be the prelude to a complete pole reversal, something which has happened hundreds of times before in Earth's history, about every 250,000 years. Although the last time it happened was over 750,000 years ago, so it looks like we are due for another pole reversal any time. Although a pole reversal takes several thousand years to complete, during this time the Earth's magnetic field would weaken considerably and might consist of multiple north and south poles spread anywhere around the globe. A weaker magnetic field would bring charged particles closer to the Earth and could create ozone holes like that which formed over the South Pole a few decades ago. This would increase the level of ultraviolet light getting through and increase the risk of things like skin cancer. It would also leave us more susceptible to solar storms, which could wreak havoc with the world's electrical power grid. By finding more weather patterns in the core, Swarm will help predict the future shape and behavior of Earth's magnetic field. But in any case, building tougher satellites is set to be big business in the coming decades, as we see a surge in the number of small sats. By launching numbers of miniaturized satellites into low Earth orbits, governments and commercial satellite operators aim to replace heavy and expensive geostationary satellites at a fraction of the cost. Small sats usually orbit below most of the radiation of the inner Van Allen belt and avoid the long-term degradation of electronics found on geostationary satellites which operate within the outer Van Allen belt. However, small sats have another problem. They frequently pass through the South Atlantic anomaly. One company working on the problem is Thales Alenia Space, a French-Italian aerospace company who are Europe's largest satellite manufacturer. They are pioneering the use of gallium nitride on silicon chips, which operate at higher voltages and temperatures than regular silicon chips, offering increased protection against radiation. In commercial applications, the loss of several nodes in a satellite network would be an inconvenience. However, if military satellite operators transition from geostationary to low Earth orbit small sats, then the effects of the South Atlantic anomaly could introduce a significant vulnerability, especially after solar storms. Whichever way we go, what is happening deep beneath our feet is going to affect what happens high above us, and ultimately, what happens here on Earth. So we need to take steps to be prepared. So what's your thoughts about the growing instability in the outer core, and what do you think we should do to counter its possible effects on our way of life? Let me know in the comments below. Don't forget you can also translate any of the Curious Droid videos with the community contributions, and we also have the Curious Droid Facebook page where you can suggest ideas for future videos. I'd also like to thank our Patreons for their ongoing support, and you can find out more by clicking on the link which is now showing. So as always, thanks for watching, and please subscribe, thumbs up, and share.